Hi, everybody. I'm here to talk to you about the economics of the 1920s. So you've probably heard of the 1920s referred to as the Roaring Twenties. Kind of has this image of being very fun, rebellious. And while there was a lot of kind of flash on the outside, there's also some economic troubles that are brewing. We'll actually get into next week more of how much of what happens in the 1920s will help lead to the Great Depression. But for now, let's just focus on economically, four main things I want you to walk away with that you understand about it. In fact, that's what the Ed Puzzle question is going to be on. Number one, what you need to understand economically about the 1920s is that there's a rise of consumerism. Remember, consumerism just means that people are buying a lot of things. In this case, they're buying a lot of new inventions. Everybody wants to get, for instance, a refrigerator, like you see here on the left, or a vacuum cleaner. A lot of household appliances were really big. On top of that, people are buying a lot of radios and even cars. Definitely remember radios and cars being bought a lot in the 1920s. Now, a lot of times these are bought on credit, and we'll talk about more next week how that's actually going to be problematic for the country. But again, a lot of people buying new things. Everybody kind of wants to get these new inventions. So that's the first big thing. How is this going to be made possible? In large part because a lot of these businessmen, industrialists are going to adopt a lot of Frederick Taylor's ideas of scientific method, including Henry Ford. He's actually going to bring in experts to kind of analyze what's the fastest way to produce a car. And so he implements some of these strategies at his Ford Motor Company that is born in the early 1900s, and he's going to use those strategies to mass produce cars like the Model T. Again, Henry Ford doesn't invent the automobile, but he is going to mass produce it. And he's going to do it in a very scientific way. So he is able to mass produce the car so quickly using these very scientific strategies that used to take over 12 man hours to produce a car. He brought it down using the moving assembly line, like what we see pictured here, down to 93 minutes. So very, very efficient. The fact that he's able to mass produce cars, and now that's going to bring the price down. And so we go from a country being, you know, primarily horse and buggies to now in the 1920s, virtually every American household had one automobile. Completely transformed society, as now people don't have to live next to where they work. They can go more places to shop, because remember, this is before the time of Amazon. It just completely revolutionizes society. So again, a lot of people buying things, especially Model T cars, radios, household appliances. Number two, now since businesses are profiting, they're doing well as people are buying these inventions, that's going to trickle down to the workers, and people's income then is going to increase. They're able to get paid more. And you can kind of see from this graph that businesses were making more things. Real GNP is kind of a measure of how much goods and services are being produced in the country. And you can see in the 1920s that that number is going up. So that's the second big thing that I want you to understand. As people are buying more things, the businesses are doing well. And so people are doing better. Their wages go up. People's income is going to increase during this time. Number three, some people are going to have extra money. And so they're going to invest this money in the stock market. And that becomes a real big phenomenon, is that people feel that they could kind of get rich in the stock market in the 1920s. More and more people begin to invest in it. And here you can kind of see proof why, because the stock market continued to go up. So again, this is broken down by president, but the president doesn't control the stock market. But this is just so you can see time frame here. If you look at all of these presidents here, this is the 1920s right here. And you can see up until Hoover, the stock market was going up big time. And so this is just like, think of the stock market as like legalized adult gambling, that you could, for very little work, next to no work, make a lot of money. Again, stocks are just when basically you own, when you buy stock, a tiny, tiny piece of that company. And so here you can see stock prices going up way more than what was normal. You know, for instance, one share of stock going from $94 to now a year later being $505, that is not normal. There was this mentality of kind of invest in the stock market and you could get rich quickly. Again, not everyone's investing in the stock market in the 1920s. It's probably only about 10% of people, but this is something that is going to be more popular in the 1920s. And this is why people had some extra money and they were able to make some more money off of that extra money. So that's the third big thing you need to understand. But while businesses are prospering, while workers are making more money, it's important to understand that about 40% of the country is still left behind, and that is the farmers, which is obviously going to be detrimental. And we'll talk again more about how this will help lead into the Great Depression next week. But we can't have our farmers suffering because we need food on our tables. Why are they suffering? Basically because of falling crop prices. Remember during World War I, there was an increased demand for farmers' crops, and you can kind of see that by the dotted line being above the solid line during World War I times. But after World War I, that demand drops, and so the prices now drop, and that drops below the solid line, which shows that farmers are now losing money. And they also had this expensive machinery, remember, they had to pay back. So it's just not good for farmers in the 1920s. Here you can see this wasn't normal living conditions. Many people were enjoying electricity at this point. Like two-thirds of homes had electricity in the 1920s. But here you can see that that is not happening in these rural areas. Same thing with this picture. Only about 10% of rural population had indoor plumbing, and about 8% had electricity. So the farmers were a major segment of the population in rural communities that are being left behind, which is an important caveat to the 1920s. And as a result, unfortunately, more and more farmers lost their farms. They couldn't afford their monthly mortgages. And there you can see, this is before the stock market crashes, before the Great Depression, farmers, a huge segment of the population, were struggling. So those are the four major things that I'd like you to remember about economics of the 1920s. Hope that helps. Thanks, guys.